them, right? So when the baby comes out, the obstetrician cuts the umbilical cord, and then the baby now goes to the pediatrician. And then the cord blood attached to the placenta will have to be delivered. That is known as the afterbirth, all right? So in that umbilical cord and placenta, there is the cord blood that remains. And as you can see from this diagram, the cord blood actually contains this type of stem cells, what we call as hematopoietic stem cells, all right? And then the surrounding it is actually the cord tissue. So within the cord blood are stem cells, which we call hematopoietic, because they are mostly responsible for forming blood elements. So that cord blood can be collected and can be stored. Okay? Back in the 70s, they have found out that this cord blood contains a very rich source of stem cells, and then they have done so many researches so that in the late 80s, they have established that this can actually be used for treatment of diseases. And as you have seen from the video earlier, more than 35,000 transplants using cord blood have been performed worldwide. So really, there is no question about it as to its efficacy, all right? So it is now considered as a standard mode of treatment, as an option for treatment of diseases. So banking the cord blood has become more and more popular these years, and basically the cord blood is collected, and then it is stored so that it can be used in the future by the child or by another person. It can be a family member, or it can be someone unrelated. So based on that, there are two business models, right? One is public banking and one is private banking. And more recently, there have been hybrid facilities, meaning they do both private and public, okay? I'm not gonna talk about that. I'll be discussing to you the pure form of public and private banking. So as you can see from this table, to differentiate public banking and private banking, in a public bank, the cord blood is a donation, meaning the parents who deliver can opt to have their baby's cord blood stored in a public bank. Okay, so it's donated to the bank, meaning they have waived ownership of that cord blood. Okay, and because of that, this is now owned by the bank. Okay, so just imagine like Red Cross, people donating blood, and there's blood in the bank that can be used by someone who will need it for treatment. Here in a cord blood bank, okay, the recipient, the one who can use it, can be anyone in the community. He's unrelated, but there is a matching procedure. This is different from the usual blood types that we know, AB, O, etc., because there is a more complex type of matching that is used for this purpose, which we call as HLA typing. All right, in most countries, this is maintained by the government. So different countries have their own public bank system. We have it in China, Taiwan, Singapore, etc. In the US, there are many public banks as well as in Europe, okay? Unfortunately, we do not have that system in the country yet. Hopefully, there will be one in the near future, but at present, there is none yet. And I'll show you this figure because if someone in the community who would need to have a cord blood unit used for treatment of a disease, they can go to a public bank and they can have a search and find a match. If you're lucky to have a match, then the cost of getting that unit is about $30,000 on the average, okay? So imagine that to be something like $1.5 million, not cheap. Right. On the other hand, if you have a private cord blood bank, this is a directed type of donation, meaning it's the parent who directs their child's cord blood to be stored in that bank. And obviously, it belongs to the child, and the one who can use it is the child himself or herself. A sibling can also be used, may also use it if there is a match. And because it is maintained by the family, there are storage fees involved that is paid for by the family, then they do not have to shed out $30,000 if the time comes when the child would need it. Of course, no parent would want to be in that situation where they would need to use that child's cord blood. I hope you understand that concept, right? No parent would want to be in that situation. But of course, many of us here are familiar with such a thing as an insurance. This is a similar type of insurance, such that if the time comes, then there is an option for them to get that cord blood for using the treatment of a disease. Now, having said that, there is always the option or the weighing of decisions whether to go into public banking or private banking. Again, as I've mentioned, public banking is a form of donation, so the family donates their child's cord blood and it can be used by anyone in the community. On the other hand, private banking is some type of self-insurance, okay? For the family who may need to use it in the future. Again, nobody wants that to happen. Okay, in the US, they have a legislation that's been passed by the US Senate back in 2005. That's 12 years ago, and that's how far behind we are. They have the recommendation that women, basically all those who consult for prenatal checkup, be provided with the perspective and information, basically an option for them to know that they can keep their baby's cord blood or to donate it in a public bank. Okay? They have set up funding for this to establish a registry of cord bank units in a public bank in the US. All right? Again, unfortunately, we are not there yet.